the so much of the emotion and of the presence of the film is in these silences, which it's hard for me to imagine as a book, and I think that the actors do such an incredible job at it. What was the casting process like for you? Did you, as an actor, did you know these actors ahead of time?
The lead actor, the doctor, I knew from my university years, because he was at the acting class, I was at the film directing, so we had some exercises together in the studios. But I never worked with him in a professional environment. But I always wanted to. And for the girl, it was harder because we needed someone not only fitting physically the story, because she had to be thin, first of all, and also she had to be believable to act from 16 to 21, the age. And not every teenager is able to, and not every young actress is able to. And sometimes you have to make a choice to make younger a female, an adult actress, like in the movie Grease, where Olivia Newton-John is like 35 and she plays 18, or the opposite, you have to choose a teenager and you have to make her older, and also that's something weird, especially when you have a close-up on the screen. But we were very lucky to find Olivia Sylger, the girl you just seen, because I believe that she was credible for both ages, and she's thin, and her face is very sensitive and also photogenic. And sometimes I just had to, and her eyes, I love the way that there was, in her eyes I find something like something that you make you feel guilty, like something like being hurt all the time, which was needed for this part. So it was a long process, obviously. I was not in love with her for the first, I mean, she was not like she stepped in like in legendary stories, like, stepping that I knew it was her. No, it took me like 4 months after I first seen her, because there were many more, also some other serious candidates. But then the major point, the decisive point, was when I saw her with him together at the last rehearsals.
It's interesting that you talk about looking for an actress who could play both young and old, because I think there's so much in the film about the space between childhood and womanhood and growth and being putting on lipstick, and where do you belong in terms of that coming of age, especially when, you know, it's been stunted, remembering that someone's still a child, and the placement of her in that role is interesting in that respect.
Yes, I have to say that I kind of highlight this aspect of compared to the novel, of the thing that it's a, in a way it's a man-woman story. It could be in other circumstances, maybe today, or maybe with another man who is not so pure and clean and heroic, and but still it's a beautiful young woman. In the novel, it's interesting that the writer never describes them in the novel, although there is space for description for a character when you write. She doesn't say how they look like, but I kind of felt somehow that she has to be pretty for herself, even for a selfish director's reason, that if I make a 90-minute long feature film, it's just better to see someone who's pretty, you know, it's from an aesthetic point of view. It's I don't know, maybe it's silly what I say, but I feel like I okay, so that's it. So the temptation was there, but bringing more into it than pure father and daughter relationship was not my idea, not the writer's idea. It was the co-writers. The script was written by another lady and me together. And when I was back with the first draft, which was a very faithful adaptation of the novel, I didn't know why it not working, but it was not working, especially the end of the movie. And then she came, this co-writer, and suggested me that what if this doctor feels by the end of the story something more, something deeper, something else, something more love-like. and then it could become some kind of melodrama. But this is just one interpretation, which I didn't want to underline in the movie. I hope I could leave some space for your own scripts in your mind, so I don't want to push this solution to you. There are many things that he could have been sad about at the end, and maybe your solution is much better, so you can just ignore what I said.
But I do think, the first moment that he puts his hand on her shoulder, there's a feeling that something might be inappropriate, and I think that later comes into play when other people are suspicious of them, and I think there's something you do something very nicely with having the audience feel the same sort of suspiciousness that is happening around them, or at least that was my feeling of some of that relationship. It's almost as if it's about to cross over a line.
Yes, that moment when the police comes, yes, but also there is a psychological explanation to that, actually, which is in the book, which is from the psychologist writer, that when there is a death close moment in life, for example, before execution, or even in the slaughterhouses for beef, I don't know how you call this anymore, cows, okay? Sometimes, sexual things can arise. It's an instinctive thing, okay? It's in the book. Here, I didn't want to know even from far such as this. I think in the screen, it's rather her who is more active and him who is pushing away. So I wanted to leave this out. But from the when you mentioned the beginning and the kitchen, I didn't want to suggest anything. So it's like for the rest, maybe for the whole movie, there's nothing else, just sexless affection.
On another topic, a few years ago, we showed 1945 here, another Hungarian film that takes place in this post-war period. And I'm interested why you think, if it's a generalization, but if there's something that's creating a mood in Hungarian cinema to talk about this post-war moment.
Well, it's also an adaptation. The 1945, a great movie, I hope some of you have seen it 2 years ago. A very different approach. It's more intellectual, my one is more emotional, I think, but it's exactly the same era. And I think still there are so many unspoken things about that period in people's mind, everyday people's mind. The society is divided in Hungary, and one part just doesn't want to talk about it at all and denies many, many things. And at that period, we had 600,000 victims of the Holocaust, and maybe a few thousand people who were involved in, like, directly actively in the process. But the majority of the society, over 90%, was just witness, silent witness. Nobody, or almost very maybe some Catholic heroes, priests or nuns, or we know about. I could count maybe 10 heroes who did actively something against. But many people just didn't do anything, and it's something similar still going on. And now sometimes we reach the point that we start to talk about something or show or write. We say, why again this? Why? We have enough of this. We never discussed it openly. And people are going to slowly die. I mean, they almost all of them dead. Were there, and I guess it's too late. So people are writing about it, people are making films about it. Although I think this film is not a Holocaust movie, it was not my intention. My intention was contrary. It was to stop blaming each other, just to move on, and maybe I wanted to focus on the healing power of love, and maybe So I don't want to get into this. But it's just a reaction. It's a reaction to a silence. That's it.
That's
okay
for the audience a chance to ask
questions. That was wonderful. I first scene when she is born. What was the meaning of that last scene?
So the question was about, was a comment about the first scene when immediately it became apparent that the gentleman knew that it was going to be a great film. And the question about the last scene, so why did you choose to not end it when they're all together, but instead have her alone on the bus?
Sometimes I get this question, and so I feel maybe that means that it's not a good ending, but but I kind of insist, I mean, I wanted to put this, even on the editing room, some people ask, we should end on the family picture, and because it would be a nice like frame, because in the beginning the camera approaches somebody on the corridor and then we just move out. But on the script, I wrote this scene, Klara alone in a bus, she's already a beautiful grown-up lady, and the camera approaches her, it's cloudy, but when it's a close-up, the sun comes out behind her. And in the shooting, it was a cloudy day, we started shooting the scene, and the camera approached her, and then the sun came up behind her. And I just thought that it's kind of a sign that I have to leave.
I loved it from the beginning also. It was a very subtle movie. You didn't hit us over the head at any time. You left us along for the journey as though we really were there, which I appreciate personally. First of all, I do want to know, how old was she in reality?
How old was
the actress?
She was 19.
Thank you. That's not really the question. Has this shown in Hungary?
Has the film shown in Hungary? Where else has it shown?
Yes, it has been released in Hungary at the end of September, so 6 weeks ago. It's still on, and it's in a few art house theaters in Budapest. But it's every evening is still sold out. So it's a good year. Like 25,000 entries, which is for that kind of movie, it's not bad. So we are very happy about it. And after Telluride, it went to Busan, Korea, and also Chicago, and now I'm here, so it's like it's a still relatively brand new experience to me.
One of the things that was in the film was about the adoption of foster children into the homes. I mean, it seemed to suggest that was a common thing. It's not something I think that we're as familiar with what was happening there from the U.S. Can you speak to that?
I'm repeating the question. The question was the adoption and the fostering of orphan children after the Holocaust common in Hungary? We see it in several instances in the film.
I cannot tell you, I'm not sure about the answer, so I don't want to say something which is not true, but I can tell you instead that these characters are fictional, as they are on the screen, but they are a mixture of people from the family of the author. So she had 35 victims in camps in her family, from if you count both sides. So I think I don't know how common was it, but it happened, this adaptation, quite often.
Congratulations. I hope you get the prize.
Thank you.
I think it was touching. I think it was a Holocaust film. But the genius was that it was so, as people have said, it was so subtle and so expertly done that it kind of transformed it into this. It was just another level. It took the tragedy and it took flashbacks, just quick scenes to fill in. That's all we need to know.
So I was just going to, for the people in the back, the comment is about the subtlety of the film and how it takes these quick scenes and it doesn't need to say that much, and that you do actually think it's a Holocaust film.
I think it's a very different one. I think it's also very intense. I think it's beautiful, and I think you've got wonderful actors across the board. And as someone just said, just coming in from the beginning, I mean, you grab right there. Who's so, coming in? What's going on?
Congratulations. So congratulations. And I guess part of the question is, if I can turn that into a question, because I think what's interesting is there is so much subtlety, and I'm curious sort of what the difference is in the way it was written in the book and turning it into a film, how you create that subtlety, or if that was on the page.
Yes, it's, usually a novel is much more talkative. There's much more information, specific information, and you can give as many background as you want for a character, for a family, or something. And in the book, you get to know the family of the doctor, Aldo, in detail, and how they died, where they died, after how much suffering, and then when he came back really like a skeleton, how, and all this you cannot put into a movie. Not only for budget reasons, and not only for the length reasons, but also for the respect of the matter, and also for this kind of stereotype design showing of the camps, of this pyjama-like, you know, prison. You know, you don't want to. I had to find out very, very simple and short and quick references. So, for example, that's how came the tatouage thing. In 5 seconds, I could show everything which I mentioned here to you or to any kind of audience. But when I wrote the script and when I showed to the writer, to the lady, she was very unhappy, unsatisfied about it, to the point that she was kind of saying that, okay, do whatever you want, but you have to take out my name from the credit list and things like this. Because reading the script, I said, Aldo is at home washing his face. There's a tatouage on his arm, and she saw is that there's nothing mentioned about his family, his children, the cancer, about it. So she was scared that I leave out everything which is important. She didn't trust me enough, not me, but she was not qualified scriptwriter, which is another subject, another profession. So it was happy, and because when she saw the film, with the music, with the actors, with the pictures, with the beauty artist, the hair, the makeup, the costume, that you've just seen, all this beautiful teamwork, she was very happy, and she sent me an SMS that you can use my name. and now she's like offended if she's not, if she gets, let me tell you that I have been in the best way.
We have time for just two more questions, yeah. Is maybe overcome with grief because he's still living with his grief, or maybe overcome with joy is right after they find out Stalin is dead. Was it intentionally ambiguous, and how was it written in the book?
It was not intentionally ambiguous, and I love both of your interpretations, the grief or the joy. Mine is the third one. My interpretation was the third one, but I'm happy with it. It's good. It's good if you can work differently. For me, it was love, sadness, immense grief for a beautiful young girl. And maybe I'm naive. I don't know. Some people took it as of my intention, and I'm happy about it. But I'm happy if you don't think at all. And I'm happy also that I mean, if I give an interview or some TV or newspaper, I don't say it. It's your privilege now that I might spoil your experience with this movie. It's a risk I take. But for me, it, at the end, it's a love story at the end. And I'm sorry, I have to say it because that was my impression.
Was it in the book?
Oh, good question, thank you. It was not in the book. It was the whole thing. After the dance school scene, nothing is in the book. Nothing. The last half hour, I and the co-writer wrote.
Right here.
Yes, as a congratulations on an amazing film, as a child of two Hungarian survivors, I felt like I entered into a world that I hadn't experienced, so thank you for that. In terms of appreciating what my parents went through after the war.
So the comment, I'm just going to start and then you can ask the question, just so they can hear in the back, was the gentleman's, the child of two Hungarian survivors and appreciated the being brought into what their experience may have been like.
Yes. So two questions or thoughts. One is there was a scene, and I think where the doctor was saying the prayer for the dead, just a snippet, was that him saying the El Rahami?
So the question
is
about the prayer for the dead,
the El Rahami. Yes, it's him. It's to show his character changing.
Yes.
Because first he says he doesn't believe anymore, and then obviously he does. Yes.
It was a brief moment, very brief.
And Aldi is very happy to see a man finally praying, because it's a man who should give the prayer, especially in such conditions.
And the last part is just, I'm curious whether you have a connection to the Holocaust at all, or your family, or, you know, whether you have a personal connection to the theme.
So when you read the novel, do you have a personal connection? What is your connection to the material?
I don't have a connection. I'm not Jewish, so my family was not affected, if that's the question. But for me, the Holocaust is not a... It's a human thing. It's not Jewish thing. So.
And I think what's interesting also is this is a period that bridges the end of the Holocaust and then coming into communism, which as a Hungarian I'm sure is something that's very much part of
Europe. We are all concerned somehow either from this side or from that side. So it's like we went from this trauma and this dictatorship in 5 years, just 5 years. 1944 it was fascism, the craziest. Raging terror in Budapest, 5 years later, craziest raging terror for the Reds. And imagine people's mentality. Prisons, the torturers, was still the same guys, same persons.
Well, and one last question for you that I had to ask is about the first scene of the film, and what's your connection to the first scene of the film?
Yes, the first thing, the young lady giving a verse, it's my wife who's playing it. Is it the question? Yes, okay, so now I can say something else as well, that the little girl plays the sister, the long dead sister of Clara, that's my daughter. So I could, you know,
thank you.
I could fare to actor budget, actor.
Thank you all for being here. Thank you.